problem is it's...
Right, good afternoon, folks. Just before we get started, Andre's family have prepared just this slideshow of some very meaningful memories. And so we're just going to let that run in the background with a bit of music. We're going to ask you just to watch that, and then we're going to start the proceedings in a few moments' time. Thank you. Well, welcome. Welcome this afternoon. We are all here because of too many who have come to know Andre as a friend, as a loving husband, as a father. We're here. We've come together this afternoon to remember him and to celebrate something of his life. And I think just the very fact that there are so many here this afternoon, here to remember Andre, here to support Karen and the rest of the family, what a testimony to the kind of friend, the kind of guy that Andre was. And so I want to welcome you on behalf of Karen and the rest of the Prinsloo family as we are gathered here today. My name, not to confuse anybody, but is also Andre. And it is, like I've said, it's a time where we are gathered here to remember and to celebrate the life of the man, Andre Prinsloo, that we have come to know. And so it would only be fitting and only be right that as we get started here this afternoon, that we ask the Lord himself to be with us now, to comfort us and keep us during this time. Please, will you pray with me? Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you. We thank you that even in times like this, times where we are missing a husband, missing a father, no doubt there, as we sit here and gather here today, where there are many of us missing loved ones, Lord, we thank you that there is a comfort found in knowing that you are here with us. Lord, that you know the hurt that it is to lose a loved one. And Father, too, that you give us a comfort which goes beyond the sting of death. And so, Father, we pray that this afternoon be a time not only of remembering Andre and the tremendous blessing that he was to his family and to many here as a friend, Father, but that this be a time of comfort, a time of closure, and a time of remembering, Lord, that you are with us today. And so be with us, we pray. We ask this in Jesus Christ's mighty name. Amen. Friends, what we're going to do before we ask Andre and the other family members to come up and share some memories, share some eulogies of Andre's life, I think it would be great that we stand and sing together. Very well-known song, Amazing Grace, but a song that is fitting for times like this. You will see there are pamphlets that have been handed out that are in the seats with the words of the lyrics. I do think many of you will know the tune, but let's stand and sing together. Thank you. Now, no doubt, I knew Andre very briefly over the last few years. Andre and Karen have been neighbors to my parents here at Kingsway. Andre Prinsloo, the Andre Prinsloo I came to know was somebody who, just meeting the very first time, already made you feel like a friend. He was always there. Whenever we were having issues with the boat motor or, you know, just needing a tool and that, Andre was always the first to offer his help, or if he had it, to be able to help out in many ways. And it's been amazing just to hear, both from Karen and the rest of the Prinsloo family and from the few of you who I've come to know, just that understanding of who Andre was one that has been experienced by, I think, all of us. He was a man who lived not for himself, but one who put others first. He was not in it for the high life, just as Andre and Kerry and Cindy just explained to me over the last few days, but he was always putting his family first, working hard, making sure that they were cared for and loved, and always there when they needed him. And so it's only right that we come to remember, you know, particular highlights, particular instances, that we come here to support Karen and the rest of the family. So I'm now going to ask, will we start with you, Andre? To come up and share some memories, some eulogies. The family have asked if there are any of you who would like to say a few words after the family are done, just to raise a hand and we'll invite you up and to come spend a few moments just reminiscing, remembering Andre. But let's start.
Thank you, everyone. To say that I'm inadequately prepared is not even doing it justice. I had some ideas in mind. I don't know how it will go. The theme of my dad's life was being on the road. Some of the guys from work will be able to attest. I was actually looking this morning some stats on how much people drive, what is the mileage, you know. People around these parts average maybe 20,000 Ks in a year. You can multiply that out, it's 200,000 in 10 years. Maybe it's a million over the course of a lifetime. My dad did possibly in excess of 5, 6, or 7 million kilometers that he personally drove in his life. And I think it wasn't just about that, it's kind of the personal journey that he undertook. I don't think, you know, he's obviously a very special character, but I think there's a lot we didn't see, and I think there was this construction that happened. When you look back on some of the early photos, some of them are not here. I was saying that, told you can see one where he's drinking that quart, you can see that's a strong man. There's kind of this raw power. I have this army photo that's not there from back in the day, and it's black and white. And I was saying to my mom and them, you could just see in that picture, like, nobody else in that photo would give him a hard time. You could see that. And over the course of this big journey, he softened, not his strength, but he turned this power into this world that he built for us. And into this magic that we've been privileged to be a part of. I don't think we even see it. We feel a little bit of the gravity and what we've seen happen here and how people have come together, how this community's come together. We see a little bit of actually what that kind of magic is. But it's, as Andre alluded to as well, you know, over this journey, he didn't collect this material wealth, but he built up this unbelievable wealth internally and externally of integrity and of strength and loyalty and things that we look to in religious leaders and some of us fight for on our knees all our lives, that somehow this personal code that he had was so unbreakable that he just never deviated from this path his entire life. And he demonstrated to us something that I think is what cracks all of us up, even the people that are sort of on the periphery of this thing, just see this force of nature that my dad was. I can't go on too much longer, but I'm going to just read something that actually came up this morning, and it's funny how these things work. According to Ralph Waldo Emerson, this is the definition of success. To laugh often and much, to win the respect of intelligent people and the affection of children, to earn the appreciation of honest critics and endure the betrayal of false friends, to appreciate the beauty, to find the best in others, to leave the world a bit better, quite a bit better, whether by a healthy child, a garden patch, quite a garden patch, or a redeemed social condition, to know even one life has breathed easier because you have lived, this is to have succeeded. And I think by that measure, my father must be the most successful person I've ever known.
I'm not as eloquent as my brother, so I'm going to read mine. Words cannot ever be enough to describe my dad, nor do any justice to the depth of feeling I have for him. Words will have to do today, and my brother did pretty amazingly a few minutes ago. He was truly the best human being I've known, and I have always known that he is the best dad anyone could ever have. I've known it like I know that this is the earth beneath my feet. His patience, enormous, boundless love and generosity, his willingness to help, do, share, provide, was something I'm always going to be in awe of. Everyone who knew my dad surely loved him. His genuine smile and infectious laughter and sharp wit made him just pure joy to be around, like moths to a flame. His flame was the crackling, woody, strong, and captivating fire you sit around. Sorry. You sit around late at night with just the moon and the stars above, and it fills your soul, and that being around that fire fills your soul. He is magic, and I was privileged on this earth to call him dad. I must have been born under a lucky star. Our family, our whole family is blessed in an immeasurable way. I'm so grateful my dad and my son got to bond. I only wish they could have caught a fish together. He loved to bounce the pots, and I'm sure all here have had the pleasure of enjoying food made by him. He was quite the wizard, and I honestly don't know what we're going to do now. I don't know what we're going to do in general. The hole he leaves is impossibly big. My mom would often liken him to the beautiful, craggy, lush mountains in certain parts of KwaZulu-Natal, and say it always reminded her of him, and it makes sense. He was so beautiful, so steadfast, solid, rugged, and actually pretty epic. I will love him and hold him in the center of my heart forever. He would always be overcome with huge emotions. Whenever we said goodbye, you could see the lump in his throat, the tear in his eye. He just seemed to be acutely aware of our limited time on this earth together, and every special moment moved him. He had the biggest heart of anyone I've ever known. I think he loved like no one else can. It's something we can all take from him, to love more. No one loses when we love a little more. Dad, I love and miss you too much. Thanks.
Something special to know the love of a consistent father, one who has been there and is always there. And I think it's just important to remember that there is nothing that truly prepares us for moments like this. We've heard from Andre and Kerry. Is there anybody else who might want to share a memory? Come on up.
Hello. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Cecile. And I'm Andre and Tani Corrin's niece. I really wanted to say a few words today, and I had this whole thing planned in my head, but I didn't realize how much a big of a responsibility it is to bring honor to such an amazing man. So I went straight to Google, and the top three things they said is, don't just keep it about the memories you shared with the person. Don't keep it longer than 5 minutes. And most importantly, try not to swear. Anyone who knows Andre knows that it only takes a second to say hello and forever to say goodbye. He made everyone feel special in his own little way. So I'm going to share the life lessons that I've learned from him. Sundays are International English Speaking Days. You never eat an apple with skin on or without aromat. Making the most of every moment and never leaving a campsite with your own made wooden spoon. The water is always wet for night swims, and always add more spice. There's a song by Cooper Allen where he sings, "Thank God for all the memories and all the pictures on my phone. They don't fill the emptiness, but I feel less alone. I know you're with the angels, right where you belong, because you were one to us, and you left the legacy of love. So I'll cry because it's over, and I'll smile because we had you. All life packed in living, although it ended too soon. So in time I'll start yelling, but even when I get the feeling, no matter where I go or what I do, I'll never not remember you." When Andre was the best handyman, roadshow partner, cook, even better than Gordon Ramsay, and absolutely had the man with the absolutely the biggest man I know, the biggest heart I know. So I'm ending up with the following. In English we say, "I miss you." In poetry saying, "Without you, there's a hollow space inside me that will never be filled." In English we say goodbye, but in poetry say, "I'll keep you tucked inside my heart forever for the rest of my life."
Thanks, Cecile. Thank you. Anybody else? Anyone else? Okay, there's somebody coming from the back. Oh, no. No, not. My apologies. Okay. As I said just a moment ago, it is times like these where there's very little that prepares one for exactly what to do and how to go about things. And I can only say, certainly from my perspective, how it's been a tremendous testimony to both Andre and to the kind of value that he has in his family as to how the family has come together and how, I've said it already, the vast number of you are here. But we also just want to make mention of those who weren't able to be here physically or in person today. There's a number who are joining us online via the live stream, so we do want to welcome you, and I know specifically Cindy, who is watching up from KwaZulu-Natal. But as these kind of things go, where there's certain logistics, there's a number of details which go into planning these kind of events, it is near impossible, certainly for the family and that, to try and nail down every detail. And so just Andre has asked me just to express that they have done their best in doing today. If there are those who might have felt left out, and that certainly we do want to honor you. If you do have something to say, here is an opportunity. Maybe something might come to mind while I'm speaking now. Please do come and chat to me if you would like to share a memory or two of Andre, what he meant to you. That would be great. Now, while there is very little that prepares us for times like this, there is one. And when I say one, I'm talking about God himself, who does give us a comfort to grasp onto when we are feeling the loss of a loved one. And so I'm going to read a few very well-known words from Psalm 23 about where that comfort is found. Psalm 23, verse 1 says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I have what I need. He lets me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He renews my life. He leads me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even when I go through the darkest valley, I fear no danger. For you are with me. Your rod and staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup, it overflows. Only goodness and faithful love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord as long as I live." Our friends, this is some great imagery, some great poetry, and it's some that certainly, no doubt, Andre would have appreciated. Andre being a guy who loved the water, who loves spending time on the water, catching fish, spending time with his family and friends around the water's edge. In fact, that's something that I enjoy profusely and enjoy just knowing that about Andre. But there is way more than just the imagery that's shared in these few words. There are a number of reasons why we can find comfort in the Lord in these times. Comfort specifically for Karen, for Andre, Kerry, Jean, the rest of the family. And I just want to pick up on two of those areas now today. Two reasons why I say that we see a comfort. Comfort, or in Afrikaans, we would know it as troos, that is seen here in Psalm 23. The first is that we are shown a picture of a clear destination, a bestemming, as we'd come to know. And then secondly, we see the presence of the shepherd. Now, this psalm, Psalm 23, while we know it and while it's no doubt read at memorial services and funerals and alongside hospital beds the world over, I'd want to caution you just from seeing it as something that's familiar, seeing it as something that's routine and that we do at times like this. There's a lot of depth to it, a lot of meaning to it. David, the psalmist, the guy who wrote this psalm, was one who became known as Israel's greatest king, but before that, most likely when he was penning the psalm, he was a shepherd. He wasn't a shepherd, you know, in kind of a romantic nature, sitting in the field, just plucking a harp. But he was a shepherd caring for sheep. He was a man's man. He knew what it was to know his sheep. I certainly suspect he was Andre's kind of man. Didn't mince his words. He didn't run away from lions and from bears that were after his sheep. And he knew his sheep. He knew his flock. He understood that a sheep on its own had no hope. And so that's why he said what he did. And first of all, what I said, what we see in the psalm is he shows us that there is a definite destination. Die herder, he says, the shepherd, he leads me. He leads me. He leads me to lie down in green pastures. Verse 2 and 3 says, he leads me to the green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He renews my life. He leads me along the right paths. In other words, it is a journey that he leads you through. And maybe for many of us, we might understand this aspect of, you know, life being a journey. We kind of get it. It's kind of something that we even celebrate in the good times. You know, we say things like, life's a journey, enjoy the ride. Okay, and that it is. And it's often then that it easily feels like God might be with us when life is going well, where things are just working out. We don't even kind of take notice. But the challenge is when we get to the difficult days. To the days where financially things just don't make sense, they don't work out. Or to those moments where we get the news that you have just lost somebody close to you, where there might not even be a reason. See, thoughts can go through our minds where we start to question and wonder, you know, why do I find myself here in the valley of the shadow of death, where it might even feel like God has left me, like I'm alone in this. Friends, the important part to remember and to be reminded of is when we find ourselves in that moment, where we feel completely alone, where there might not even be any explanation as to how we got where we are. There's a very important word that I want to remind you of that we read when we reflect on Psalm 23. And that word is through. Even when I go through the darkest valley, the valley of the shadow of death, David can say, I fear no danger. Selfs al gaan ek deur die donker dieptes, sal ek nie bang wees nie. And that word is important. It's important because it reminds us, it shows us that that valley, whatever it might be, you know, right now, the difficulty and the pain of losing Andre, it means that that is not the destination. The valley of darkness is never the end road. In other words, what we have to understand here, the point that David, that the psalm is making, is that there is hope beyond darkness. And friends, that is not just a maybe. That is a promise. That is a promise. There is one who will lead you through the valleys. And so that brings us to the second point. You see, all along, all through the journey of the shepherd guiding his sheep, the grazing to the resting, to the watering, to the guiding and guarding and passing through the dangerous valleys, we see through every step of the way the shepherd is with his sheep. Even when I go through the darkest valley, I fear no danger. Why? Well, David says, because you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Selfs al gaan ek deur donker dieptes, sal ek nie bang wees nie, want u is by my, he says. In your hande is ek veilig. In your hands, I'm safe and secure. And friends, it's often in times like this, where we're reminded that it is the Lord's presence, God's presence, that truly matters. I don't know if many of us know one another, but I know certainly Karen has come to know the noise of our three daughters over the years as we've come to spend time at the river. We are in that stage of life with three younger kids. And my middle daughter, Madison's her name, she's the rough and tumbler of the three. She's the ruffian, the tough one. But maybe what doesn't seem to make sense, certainly to me, is that our roughest of our three bunch, she's the one who fears the dark the most. And what amazes me is even in our own house, she's scared of the dark. And so what will regularly happen is we'll have the normal kind of bedtime routine. The kids will go to bed and then she'll ask either her mum or myself, you know, to turn the light on. And well, you know, as parents, what we want to do is we want to equip her not to be afraid of the dark all the time. And so what I'll often say to her is, Maddie, you know, you have an option. I can either turn the light on and leave the room and say goodnight to you and go to bed. Or I can stay here in the dark with you. And do you know what that little daughter of us chooses every single time? Not the light on, though she is afraid of the dark. Every time she chooses me to stay. In other words, she chooses presence in the darkness over absence in the light. And friends, isn't that what we all need most in our valleys? See, I think whether we admit it or not, know it or not, our greatest fear, no matter how tough or rough you might be, is to truly be alone. See, that was the blessing that Andre was to his family and to so many of you as a friend. He was there. He was there in so many ways. And that is a blessing, a gift from God himself. And we thank God for that. But there is one. There is one who will never leave or forsake. See, the thing about the shepherd that David writes about is that we see that he's not only with you all through the way, but he describes that he's also equipped for the job. that he has the tools for what is needed. The English tells us that he has a rod and a staff with him. Those are the tools needed, used to defend the sheep from their prey, or to kind of that crook to grab sheep, you know, when they fall off a ledge or whatever it might be. The shepherd is not only there to comfort, but he's there to defend you. And he is fully equipped to do that. And the thing is, for many of us, we might think, well, you know, you might say to me, you know, Andre, that's nice. That's nice. That even makes sense. That's interesting. But what difference does it make for me now? What difference does it make for how I am feeling right now? Well, I would say the answer lies in who the shepherd is. See, Jesus Christ, the Son of God himself, in John chapter 10 says this. He says, I am the good shepherd. And the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Ek is die goeie herder. Die goeie herder lê sy lewe af vir die skape. Jesus is that true shepherd of the sheep. He truly understands the sheep. In other words, he truly understands you and I. He knows us. He knows you. He understands what you're going through even in those darkest valleys. He can identify you. Why, friends? Well, because he's been there. He's been there. He's stood in our place. He has mourned the loss of a loved one. He has felt the sting of death. In fact, he has taken death on himself. And his tool was simply a wooden cross. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Die goeie herder lê sy lewe af vir die skape. He came down to the world. He walked through the valley of the shadow of death. And as we come to celebrate in Easter, he went to death, even death itself, to take on the sting of sin, to take on the sting of death, so that we didn't ever have to truly know it. Friends, Jesus Christ is the one who took our death, your death, my death, on himself, so that he could give us a hope beyond death, so that he could say, I am with you, and that could be an eternal promise. Verse 6, Psalm 23 says, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord as long as I live. That is a promise. That is a promise for anybody who comes to that shepherd. Knows that he is for them and they are for him. There is hope, and there is hope even beyond the sting of death. There is comfort to be found in him. But that comfort is in his presence. Friends, when we see what it is for a family to truly mourn, the kind of husband that Andre was, the father that he was, when you hear what a blessing he was to so many, that is just a glimpse of the kind of presence, the kind of comfort that you can find in Jesus Christ. And that is a hope you can hold on to even now. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we not only remember the kind of man that Andre was, kind of father, the kind of husband, the uncle, the friend, as I've heard today, Father, a mentor to so many in the workplace over the years. His dedication both to his work and his family in driving so many kilometers. Father, we do truly thank you for the blessing that he was to the Prinsloo family, and to so many here today. And no doubt, Lord, there is a gap left by Andre Prinsloo. There is a void left by him and his family and his friends. Just thinking of his plans of retirement and spending some good time here at the water. But Father, we thank you too that when we are reminded of the sting of that, Father, that we can see a comfort that is found in you saying that this is not the end. That there is more, and that you are with those who mourn today. And so, Father, I pray simply now this afternoon that you, that wonderful counselor, that great shepherd of the sheep, that comforter, Father, that you hold the Prinsloo family warmly in the palm of your hands, that you are with them over the coming days and months, Lord, that you are with many of us. And Father, you show us the hope that there is, even in times like this. Lord, that these valleys are not the final destination, but you will lead us home, we pray. May that be found in Christ. And it's in your name and for your glory we pray. Amen. Friends, we're going to kind of close off this time, this afternoon, but we're going to do that in a way which not only remembers one of Andre's favorite songs that Tom's going to play for us in a few moments' time. The pictures will carry on rolling over on the screen behind me, but Andre and the rest of the family have asked that if you don't have to, that you don't, certainly don't feel that you have to rush off this afternoon. The family are going to be here at the slab. There's going to be some fires that are lit later on this afternoon. And we really, I certainly would like to encourage you to stick around, maybe now straight away, enjoy some coffee and tea. Let the family know that you are there for them. But let's just take these last few moments to reflect and to remember Andre. I'm going to finish with these words. We're going to hear the song, and then as the song ends, we can stand and kind of gather and enjoy this time together. But my prayer for you is that God's gracious mercy and protection be known by you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you. Okay, friends, that brings our time to an end this afternoon. I think on behalf of the Prinsloos, just want to say thank you to Johan and the many of you who have made this afternoon possible by bringing along things, helping with the seating and so forth. Thank you to Tom for handling the sound and the live stream. In case, I know I would have missed a number of names, but just to thank you and remind you what a great bit of support this is for Karen and the rest of the family. Friends, thank you very much. And please do stick around for some tea and not rush off. Sorry, just one last thing. Let's do this.